August 17th, 2015, with Howard S. Becker. We're out here in San Francisco at the San Francisco Institute of Art. Howie's been kind enough to carve out some space for us. Before we get to the substance of the interview, as usual, we'll begin with a brief introduction to his life's work. But before we do that, I think we should point you, anybody interested in additional materials on Howie's work, how he actually operates, manages a website, Howard S. Becker, Howard S., his middle initial, Becker.com. There's there's a plethora of materials out there that give you a better notion as to the totality of his work. Howie began his academic career at the University of Chicago, earning a PhD in 1946, an AM, a master's degree, in 1949, and a PhD in sociology from their sociology department in 1951. Before proceeding, it might be helpful for us to know, you completed your PhD, which is actually an undergraduate degree, in 2 years. Was that a wartime contingency?
I think it was three years.
Truncated?
Because I started, no, I got a scholarship.
Okay.
When I was at the end of my second year of high school, I took some kind of competitive exam.
All right.
That my homeroom teacher told me to go take the exam, and I did, and I was awarded a scholarship at the University of Chicago. So that's where I went.
Okay.
After 2 years of high school.
Yeah.
University of Chicago College then, I don't think they do this now, but they routinely admitted third-year high school students.
Oh, wow.
As college students.
All right.
And in 4 years, you know, you would take a variety of courses.
Okay.
Which was also a very weird curriculum, because you had to take 13, as I remember, one-year-long courses, 3 years of social science, 3 years of natural science, humanities, etc. And at the end of each year, you took a six-hour exam. That was your grade. You didn't have to go to class. You didn't have to write anything. You never had to, you know, take an exam, nothing. And if you passed 13 comprehensive exams, you were in business. You got your degree. Well, if you took four classes a year, which was pretty standard, and took one in the summer, there's your 13, and it's 3 years. So I entered in 43, I graduated in 46.
And that accounts for why you were 23?
Well, that's part of it.
When you graduated with your PhD?
Yeah, I skipped a couple of grades in grammar school. And then after I got to Chicago, you know, I got my bachelor's degree, and I was, 18 years old, I think. And I was still living at home with my parents, and like, I knew my father was not going to put up with me quitting school and becoming a full-time piano player on 63rd Street, so I figured I had to go to graduate school. And I was going to go into literature, but I read Black Metropolis, Drake and Caton, that summer, and I decided to become a sociologist. So that's how I did that. And then I didn't take graduate school quite as seriously as a lot of my colleagues, you know, because it was just a hobby. I mean, it was, my real thing was playing the piano. And I was studying with a very fine piano teacher, Lenny Tristano, and, you know, very actively working for 3 to 6 nights a week. So I just, you know, did whatever had to be done. And pretty soon there I was with a master's degree. And then I went to see Everett Hughes, who was my major professor. He had been the chair of my, you know, master's thesis committee, and went to say goodbye. You know, goodbye, Professor Hughes, I'm leaving. So he looked at me and just totally ignored what I had said. And he said, have you applied for a fellowship? I said, no, sir, I just told you I'm leaving. He said, go apply for a fellowship. So, okay, I applied for a fellowship. I guess he saw to it that I got it. And I also didn't, you know, take like the prelims seriously. Everybody else spent a year studying for prelims. And it was pretty obvious that most of the prelims, you didn't have to know that much. Like with Herb Bloomer's prelim about social psych, Herb had sort of a body of 10 or 15 definitions and principles, and if you learned those and learned how to work with them, you could answer any question that he would ever ask, because you didn't have to know anything else. You just had to know how to give the answer that he wanted to hear. And it was like that. So I skated through those, and then Hughes had hired me to interview school teachers, and that was my dissertation. He said, you might as well make your dissertation out of that, so I did. And then, you know, there I was like 23 years old, and I had a PhD, and as I tell people all the time, it was a question either of being the most educated piano player on 63rd Street, or trying to take sociology seriously.
And there was also that question of going out on the academic job market and becoming an assistant professor, and you commonly quip in interviews and elsewhere that why would you hire a kid when you can have a real life adult?
Well, so. That's right. I mean, I was 23 years old, and, you know, and I didn't look like a professor at all.
So,
and there was one job, Ernest Burgess called me, because one of my fellow students, Harold McDowell, had also graduated, and Harold had taken a job at the University of North Dakota. And then he got an offer from Vanderbilt, which he knew was better. So after much soul searching, he arrived at the decision I knew he was going to arrive at, and he told North Dakota too bad and went to Vanderbilt. So Burgess called me and wanted to know if I wanted to go to North Dakota. And I thought about it for about 10 seconds and said no. But then, you know, things happened. Like I got a job teaching in the college of the University of Chicago. That's a whole long story.
Yeah.
It was a very different place. It had nothing to do with the department in the social science program. Because a streetcar, this, you won't believe this, but during the winter, Christmas break, a streetcar fell over during a storm on a car being driven by one of the teachers in the Social Science 2 course and put him out of commission. And so they desperately needed someone to teach. And there I was, and people knew me, you know, mainly through Everett, and David Reisman was the head of this course. And so they hired me to do that. And then Everett went on leave the next year to Germany, so the department hired me to teach his fieldwork class. So between the college and the department, I had a full-time teaching job. And I also, somewhere in there, I got hired, not hired, but I talked the Institute for Juvenile Research into hiring me, not paying me, out of a grant they had for studying drug use among youth, because heroin had suddenly come to everybody's attention, and the Institute had gotten a big grant to study drug use among youth. And so I said, look, pay me, you know, $50 a week, and I'm going to interview marijuana users. And the people who ran the place said, well, that's, you know, that's not interesting. Marijuana use is, you know, it's not a problem. So I said, I know, but I want to study it because I read Alfred Lindesmith's classic work, and I think I can do something similar that will apply his ideas and it'll be interesting. Well, you know, finally said, oh, well, what the hell? Give the kid a break. And So they paid me to do that. And that's where the marijuana study came from.
I think you kind of referred to that period as your research bum kind of period.
The research bum went on until 65.
Right. So you were research associate at the Chicago Area Project / the Institute for Juvenile Research from 51 to 53. Then the Ford Foundation hires you as a postdoctoral researcher.
There was a postdoc program at the University of Illinois.
Yeah.
That Ford had funded, and they brought in six psychologists and sociologists a year, and my friend Elliot Friedson, who was became a well-known medical sociologist, had become one of the fellows the year before. It was a two-year fellowship, and he said, "This is great. They don't make you do anything, and you can get some work done. You have to live in Urbana." He said, "That's the downside." So okay, so we went down there, and for 2 years, I worked closely with a psychologist named Jim Carper, and we did a study of occupational identities among graduate students, which we published a couple of papers. And then while I was there, Hughes called me one spring that I would be leaving and said, in his wonderfully abrupt way, he said, "Meet me in Kansas City tomorrow morning." I said, "What for?" He said, "We're going to study a medical school." I said, "We are?" He said, "Yes, be there." So met him, and he had worked out a deal with the dean of the University of Kansas Medical School to do a big research project. And so I was the vanguard of that. And I went down there. I worked for an outfit called Community Studies Incorporated, which was a kind of, it was the offspring of a collection of local trusts and foundations, which had been put together. And the guy who ran it said he needed to have a research arm. So they had created Community Studies Incorporated, and that was their research arm. They funded it. But it also could be a repository of grants. So Everett got a grant from some foundation to study the medical school, and we did that. And then we wrote a book, and then he got another grant to study the undergraduate college of the University of Kansas.
So there were two books that were produced out of that, The Boys in White, and then Making the Grade. That was a subsequent work.
Right. So that was my research bum period.
Yeah, but there was also, then you segued to the research associate at the Institute for Study for Human Problems at Stanford.
Yeah. Well, after, it's a long, complicated story. I'm not sure that criminologists care about this, but Nevitt Sanford was a well-known psychologist. I mean, you can't imagine how easy it was to raise money in those days. And Nevitt had got $1 million from the National Institute of Mental Health to start a big program to study alcoholism. And he was a professor at Berkeley, but Berkeley didn't want to take the money for God knows what reason. But Stanford was very happy to take the money. So Nevitt moved to Stanford, and he hired a bunch of his old cronies, essentially, psychologists and a philosopher. And there was a group of sociologists who were very into studying alcoholism. Dave Pittman and Chuck Snyder were the ringleaders, and they were deeply offended that there were no sociologists on the staff of this thing, and they raised hell.
So they must have read some of your published work.
Nevitt?
You had published on your marijuana by that point.
Yeah. Well, Nevitt studies on marijuana. Nevitt knew me because he was involved by that time in research on higher education. So I'd met him, at conferences and whatnot, because We would be the token fieldwork people amidst all these psychologists. And so he knew that I was a nice guy and that he and I got along. So he called me up and offered me a job at Stanford. I said, to do what? He said, whatever you like. So you're going to be our sociologist. Keep these guys quiet.
So you spent some time at Stanford, and then you entered as a full professor at Northwestern University.
That's when Ray Mack,
right,
who had been courting me for a couple of years then, we met each other because of music. He was a drummer, and I was a piano player, and we met years before because Ray had gotten a PhD at North Carolina, and then his first job was teaching at Mississippi. And Ernest Burgess, having retired, was teaching at Mississippi. And Ernest said, oh, you're a drummer. You should meet one of our young students who just graduated. He's a piano player. So Ray came looking for me at the ASA meetings. He said I wasn't hard to identify. I was the only one wearing a zoot suit. And we got to know each other. And when an opportunity arose at Northwestern, he made the best of it. And by that time, you know, I was a saleable property. I mean, I published two books.
Right, the Outsiders would have been published a couple years before that.
Yeah, Outsiders and
the two education things.
So, you know, that's a full professor.
So you were there from 65 to 91, mm-hmm. and then you moved from 91 to 99 up the coast to the University of Washington in their sociology department. You also held the position as an adjunct professor in their School of Music from 95 to 99. Along the way, you served as editor of Social Problems from 61 to 64. Just for the record here, we'd like to kind of tick off some of the distinctions and honors that you've acquired over the course of your illustrious career.
You're going to make me blush.
you've served as president for the Society for the Study of Social Problems from 65 and 66. You're a fellow at the Center for the Advanced Studies in Behavioral Sciences, that's over in Palo Alto on the Stanford campus in 69 and 70. One of the few who have dabbled or addressed criminological concerns that have served in that capacity. You've served as president of the Society for the Study of Symbolic Interactionism, 77-78. You've been awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship. You were a Guggenheim Fellow in 78 and 79. You were awarded the Charles Horton Cooley Award by the Society for the Study of Symbolic Interactionism in 1980. You've earned the Cooley Mead Award bestowed by the American Sociological Association in 85. With their section on social psychology. You've earned the George Herbert Mead Award for Career of Distinguished Scholarship from the Society for the Study of Symbolic Interactionism in 87. You've also earned an award for a Career of Distinguished Scholarship by the ASA in 1998. And you've acquired any number of honorary doctoral degrees. You've written a number of important works. We've referenced Outsiders. We'll loop back to that here momentarily. You've done a number of different works in the sociology of education, the Boys in White and the Making the Grade, a couple of co-authored works. In art, your Sociology of Art Worlds was produced, published in 1982. You've done any number of works on addressing in some measure of detail the methodology of qualitative research, playing great care to that. Tricks of the Trade and Telling Society being two important works within that aspect of your overall agenda. Also, many in sociology and many in criminology, at some point during the dissertation phase, because writing is so important, have almost inevitably consulted your writing for social scientist produced in 1986. And most recently, you produced a book that actually probably most popularly known, more circulated reference to this work, What About Mozart, What About Murder. The book actually circulated first, well, in some ways, within the New Yorker. So that brought you back to the sort of public attention once more in some real meaningful way.
Well, it's a lot more public attention than
Yeah.
That's a different world.
Well, it's just interesting that you've published after you've been retired for several years. So the mind is still very,
well, Brendan,
very active.
I have to keep out of trouble.
You might end up back in jazz bars,
God
strip
knows
joints.
No, that world is gone. That's all gone.
I'm wondering if we should maybe start with a little bit maybe of a biographical reference. You've written a little bit of work, which appears on your website, kind of detailing your early exploits in Chicago, taking the L from your West Side boyhood home downtown to kind of explore and see the sights and look at social mm-hmm. interactions. I'm wondering where the deviance.
Well, I don't
at.
Think I was thinking of it quite that way.
You probably weren't, right?
No, it surely wasn't.
I do get the sense, though, from that writing that there is just sort of an innate sense of wonderment about.
No, it was so interesting, Brendan.
Right.
Jesus, you know, you'd. Chicago's a big city.
Right.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up in southern Indiana, and I spent a good portion of my undergraduate and graduate career actually in Chicago on the north side as well. So I can definitely sense how,
well, you know,
how alive
the,
it is.
At the age of 10 or something like that,
yeah.
And it's inconceivable that parents would, middle class parents would let a child do this
yeah.
these days. But, you know, my mother would give me a sandwich, and my buddy and I, he had a sandwich. And we'd get on the L, pay one fare, and you could ride the L, you know, to the other end of the line. You could, the Lake Street L downtown, get off, transfer to Jackson Park, you know, and go to the south side, and then ride that train all the way up to Evanston, and then go out to the southwest side. I mean, you could be all over the city, looking out the window, because it was all above ground then. And so you're seeing different neighborhoods, you see signs in different languages, different kinds of housing. You're looking in people's windows because the L often went right by an apartment. We never saw the naked ladies we hoped to see, but can't have everything. And then later on, when I was older, like 12, 13, I would get off downtown and spend hours in the loop just wandering around. I mean, I'd go in these old office buildings, you know, and take the elevator to the top floor and just walk around and see what was in every office. I mean, they're like, there'd be a wholesale jewelry place, and then next door would be a private detective agency and like that. I mean, just I'd walk down, you know, from the top floor down to the street and do that all over.
Now, how did the interest in deviance, I don't think that you were actively deviant. As a matter of fact, in that piece, you actually referenced the fact, I really like this aspect of the story, that the only time you've ever stolen anything in your life was you saw a translated work of Weber.
Oh, that's
on
when
display.
I was a graduate student.
Right. And your marijuana use came only after you were immersed in that environment for a period of time.
Many graduate students stole at least one book. And if you didn't, shame on you.
What's the statute of limitations on that? So where did the interest in deviance then arise
from?
Well,
I didn't have an interest in deviance.
Yeah.
What I had was, I was studying, you know, I'd done my master's thesis on musicians, who I didn't regard as deviant exactly, but that was an occupational study. That was a study in the sociology of work. And then, as was my PhD thesis about teachers, very heavily influenced by Hughes. And then when I did the marijuana thing, I did that not because it was a deviant activity, but because I'd read Alfred Lindesmith's book on opiate addiction. I don't know if anybody reads it anymore, but it's a classic. I mean, it's a fabulous piece of research. Every bit as good now as it was then. And Lindy's idea was that addiction was a function of people engaged in addictive behavior after they had learned to define the withdrawal symptoms of opiate addiction as something that had been caused by taking those drugs, and they could be cured by taking more. And that it became that kind of object. I mean, this is straight George Herbert Mead, as interpreted by Herbert Bloomer.
Right. Was there ever an awareness at one point that I don't think this is deviant, but other people do?
Well, everybody knew it was illegal.
So yeah.
But Lindy didn't pay any attention to that. I mean, that was not his problem. Mm-hmm. His problem was, how did they become addicted? Well, it's no secret that young people of my age in the music business were very likely to be smoking dope, which in fact I was doing. And so I knew that marijuana was not habit forming, that was nonsense. And I also knew that there was this funny thing about marijuana use, is that people often, when they first used it, said, well, what is it? I don't feel anything. And other people who were more experienced might observe them and say, look, he's eating his third hamburger. And so you would say to them, did you ever eat three hamburgers before? I'd say, no. I'd say, well, that's it. And you would point out things to them. And once they had pointed out to them the characteristic features of a marijuana high, then they could want to do that. Mm-hmm. But before that was just something, you know, it had nothing to do with it.
It also seems like you, in some ways, kind of fell into the research process as well. Looking back at how you describe this, it's just sort of, it's very old school Chicago, just get out there and explore and keep your eyes awake.
No, this was aware. This was analytic induction.
Okay.
Which is a business that Florian Zanetsky had invented for sociologists. And Linda Smith had used it very explicitly and self-consciously. And the idea is to focus on negative cases, to look for cases that don't support your hypothesis. So, I mean, what I was doing was interviewing people who I found who smoked dope and essentially asking them, tell me about the first time you ever got high, what happened? And they would tell me a story, and then I would ask questions. Okay, part of it was, of course, that after, and this is the part that Lindy did not do, I knew that part of becoming a marijuana smoker, so to speak, was taking care of the auxiliary problems that arise. What am I going to tell the people where I work if I act a little oddly? What am I going to tell my parents? What am I going to tell this one or that one? And that that was a matter of taking account of the fact that this was thought of as a very naughty thing to do. And that's where the deviance came in, because simultaneously, you know, Goffman was working out his ideas. And so like his paper on cooling the mark out.
Now, he was a peer reviewer, was that, in Chicago?
Yeah.
So were you two kind of bandying ideas back and forth?
Oh, yeah. Hey, we walked our babies together down Hyde Park Boulevard.
Were you also exposed to some of that in terms of your training? Because Chicago has a definite bearing on the development of symbolic interactionism. Just in general, was that part of your formal training that kind of attuned you to this is the method?
Well, you shouldn't imagine that anybody had a program there.
To
teach us anything. You know, there were 8 or 10 professors, and each one taught what he knew and what he was interested in. I've heard Bloomer was the nearest thing to a theory class that we got. Because Herb, that was all theory. Why his theory was better than all the other theories, why the other theories were no good, all of which we mostly accepted as being more or less sensible, which they were, in fact. Hughes didn't have a program like that. He was a But he was a dedicated student of Robert Park. Mm. And his idea was, he was the one who like go out and, you know, there's that famous quote from Robert Park, go out and get the seat of your pants dirty, sitting in the burlesque theaters or the high class hotels. And so, and that was Everett Hughes. Louis Wirth was supposed to teach theory, but he didn't. I mean, he was a very poor excuse for a teacher. He essentially didn't do anything. I mean, he just sit there and bullshit. He would read his mail to you. And Ogburn had his thing that he was peddling, which was social change and cultural lag. Mm-hmm. It was like that. Yeah. You know, nobody had a program. There was no University of Chicago program to teach.
You do write a little bit, though, that you did realize that the thing that was going on in Chicago was kind of unique, or it had some measure of distinctness to it, in that you contrasted over and against the Parsonians that you had encountered.
Well, that,
equilibrium was kind of their thing.
You have to understand this as like post-war political maneuvering. Mm-hmm. Among Chicago had always been the major department. I mean, there was nothing to argue about.
Yeah.
They produced most of the PhDs. Anywhere you went in the country, the teachers in the universities were likely to be PhDs from Chicago. I mean, a few people got a degree at Columbia under Giddings. Bogardus had a PhD program in Southern California. Early on, George Lundberg had a kind of a fanatic program of his thing in Seattle. But, you know, I never counted, but I mean, I would say 80 to 90% of the PhDs were surely from Chicago. So it was essentially the only game in town. After the war, before the war, there was already a rebellion. People elsewhere in the country who were, remember, the major journal was the AJS.
Which was
quartered
at
the University of Chicago. The editors were always members of the faculty. The other two were whatever Bogardus's journal was called, and Social Forces, which was kind of respectable, but it had a very southern slant and demographic. And the ASR was founded in 1937 as a rebellion against the domination of Chicago. It was very explicit. So they started that. After the war, there was a lot of money around. This is something you have to appreciate. Suddenly, and it was partly to do with, you know, science had proved itself during the war, atom bomb, blah, blah, blah. Russia was becoming a problem. And so money had to be given for scientific research. It's not that anybody thought that social science was going to do any good, but you know, a few crumbs came to social science, which were still sizable compared to what had been available before. And so Lazarsfeld teamed up with Merton to start a research center. And I mean, they had a very clear program to make a dent and have an alternative. And Parsons had been, you know, he'd studied in Germany and he translated Weber. And so he was building a program at Harvard, and he produced a generation of people who turned out to be very influential, like Kingsley Davis, Bob Merton, I forget, there's quite a few of them, who were a Harvard thing. And I mean, nobody could make head or tail out of Parsons' theory. Mm. So they did the best they could, and they invented their own.
And a lot of your work seems to be a critique of Parsons, in that you seem to be about the concrete and about this abstraction is something that you just don't have much interest in.
I didn't read a whole lot of Talcott Parsons.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't make any sense out of it. I mean, I couldn't see anything I could do research on.
Oh.
You know, but it wasn't a critique of Parsons as such. It wasn't aimed as a critique. It was like, hey, this is the way I do it.
Hmm.
And the way I do it is the way I learned from Hughes and Lloyd Warner and Allison Davis and those kind of people around Chicago. And it was a way of gathering a lot of information about whatever you wanted to study. It wasn't only qualitative.
Mm, yeah.
I mean, the first thing that I learned from Everett Hughes was he gave us, in his fieldwork class, he gave us a census tract. Each two people had a census tract. First thing you did was look in the Chicago area, whatever it was called.
The fact book or...
Chicago area fact book. For your community area and find out all the demographic and health and police data that they had in that book. Those were fabulous books. I don't know why they stopped doing it. And I remember when I moved out to California and I was living in San Francisco, I said to somebody, where's the community fact book for San Francisco? He said, there isn't any. Chicago's the only place that has that. Because that seemed to me like, you know, a necessity. If you're going to do research, of course you want to know who's living there and how old they are and all that. So I haven't really organized my work or my life or my thinking around opposition to things.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I'm not fighting with anybody. They want to do it that way, you know,
right.
God bless them.
Yeah.
Who knows, maybe they're right.
Okay.
I don't think so, but you know.
Yeah. Could you talk to us a little bit about some of the students? We've already mentioned Goffman here. Seemed to be an illustrious group of students the faculty there as well.
I've been working with a French scholar, Daniel Safai, on a study of our generation at Chicago. Essentially, it's people who were there between 45 and 55 who got degrees. I mean, Danielle has done a mountain of archival research, just quite incredible. He's read all these dissertations that were done, you know, like over 100 dissertations. And the thing is, when he started, he would say to me, okay, now this one, was he a member of the group? I'd say, what group are you talking about? He said, you know. You know, don't be coy. You know, you and Goffman and Gusfield and Friedson, you know, the group. So there was no group. There were like 100 plus people, all of whom had differing interests, no two alike, studying with some latching onto Bloomer, like Tamatsu Shibutani was I don't even know if you know the name.
Yeah.
He was a student of Herb Bloomer's, but also of Hughes. He wrote a great book on crowd behavior called Improvised News. It was about rumor. It's a classic work. And then many years later, he wrote a book called The Derelicts of Company K, which is about a Nisei company in World War II. And the story of Company K was it was half Nisei from the mainland and half from Hawaii. Well, I don't know if you know anything about Nisei, but the Hawaiians are considered by the mainland to be rowdy, noisy, impolite, they have no culture, etc., etc. And, you know, the stereotype of the Southern California, Northern California, Nisei was very polite, very quiet, very proper, etc. And so Tom was in this this regiment made up half and half. Of course, they didn't get along. There were huge arguments and fights all the time. He kept a complete diary. Well, keep a diary when you're in the Army, turns out, it's not so easy to do. What he did was he wrote long letters every day to Everett Hughes, to Herbert Blumer, and those were his field notes. And they saved them and gave it to him. And years later, he wrote this book on the basis of that.
Do you have any idea what was it about the Chicago environment that instilled these kinds of skills that ultimately proved to be successful?
Well, I mean, some skills, you know, everybody had to take the field work class. Yeah. I mean, you didn't have to take anything, but you arrived, right, in September, and they said, okay, you'll take field work and statistics and theory, or introduction to sociology that Burgess taught, and a statistics class, and Everett's field work class. So everybody had that field work class. It wasn't like some weird thing they didn't know about. They'd done it. And they understood what it was. And, you know, that was...
And then the quantitative as well. You said that there wasn't really any rift.
No, there was. I mean, there were differences.
Right.
Like we were talking about Jim Short. Mm-hmm. I mean, Jim and Andy Henry both were students of Ogburn. Mm-hmm. They wrote very statistical dissertations, which they published as a co-authored book.
Yeah. That was a supplemental, that was a homicide report, I believe, that the UCR just put together. Mm-hmm. So.
And, but when Jim went to do studies of gangs in Chicago, he very quickly turned to field work because that was the way to find out what he wanted to know. So there was no, and look, when I did my master's thesis about musicians, you know, the great ecological exercise of making a spot map? You map the phenomena like Sean McKay mapped delinquency, and somebody else mapped suicides, and somebody else mapped the addresses of people who were in the state mental hospital. I made a map because I had the address book that you got when you were a member of the American Federation of Musicians, Local 10, Chicago. So I got one of these big maps of Chicago that they had in the bookstore for just this purpose. And I sat there and put little dots all over the map, which was divided into community areas and probably census tracts as well. And I was very disappointed. Can you guess why? There was no pattern.
Yeah.
Musicians were all over the city. Huh. And like a dumbbell, I didn't realize this is a finding. You know, this is not like that. These people come from everywhere. Huh. You know, they come from every social class, every ethnic group, et cetera. Not from every racial group, because there was a separate black union at that time. But, so, and it, to me, it seemed like the most natural thing to do. Mm. Because that's what I learned, that's sociology. So, and all the books that I looked at, I mean, Black Metropolis is filled with tables.
Yep.
Lloyd Warner's books, I mean, or Deep South, which was another classic that I learned from, is filled with numerical data. I mean, I wasn't taught to.
Before you got to, before we get to the classic work here in 63, The Outsiders, I'm kind of wondering if we can backtrack to 1960 with your work on notes on the idea of commitment to conformity. Where did that come from?
It wasn't commitment to conformity.
Let me find my notes here.
It's notes on the concept of commitment.
Correct. So you worked to clarify.
It wasn't conformity. I mean, that's a big point.
Right.
If you thought it was.
Right. Maybe I'm imputing meaning into that. what's happening.
What it was
there.
Was commitment to a line of activity.
Right.
So it's not the same thing.
Correct. Correct.
Commitment to any line of activity.
Yeah.
What does it mean to be committed? And my argument was, it was taken, by the way, from the work of Thomas Schelling.
Huh. On his strategies of conflict.
Yeah.
Huh.
Because he talked about how people get committed, that it gets too expensive to change your strategy.
Huh.
Because you've already got sunk costs. I mean, it's an economic concept. You know, you've already put this into it, so you got to keep going. You can't. It's like, why did I finish my PhD? Well, what else am I going to do? In sociology, why didn't I change to literature? Hmm. Well, you know, like I've taken these exams and I've learned this and that. And it's easier to do it this way. And that's the whole idea of commitment. It has nothing to do with
the conformity. Correct. Right. So that's commonly cited within the control theory literature. Did you have any conceptualization of control? Well, control maybe arose later, and it just got brought into that.
I remember that. When did control theory get?
It was formalized in 1969 with Travis Hershey's famous statement.
I'd written Outsiders,
right?
Years before that.
Yeah.
There was no control theory then.
Yeah. There were a handful of papers that were kind of leaning in that direction. Well, it was kind of inchoate at that point there in terms of.
Yes, I wasn't prescient enough to know that it was going to turn into control theory.
Right.
What I was interested in was the creation of deviance by definition.
Oh.
That's what Outsiders is about, and it's pretty clear.
Yeah.
See, I'm always, this is not aimed at you, Brent.
Sure.
It's aimed at the world.
Our viewers.
Everybody. People don't read very carefully anymore.
Yeah. You know,
everybody knows what deviance theory is, right?
I think sometimes history has a way of kind of recharacterizing or re-narratizing things, and it puts things in conceptual boxes, and we don't visit the original text.
That's right.
So it just kind of gloms together.
Because I can't tell you how often I read Becker says.
All right.
Or not long ago, I caught a very well-known philosopher totally misquoting Thomas Kuhn on the nature of scientific activity.
Huh.
I mean, you can go to the Kuhn's book and find the exact quotation that shows that this guy has got it backwards.
Yeah.
And it's obvious he didn't look. He didn't read the goddamn book. I mean, it's... I didn't have a deviance theory.
Yeah.
What I had was a general description of a process by which some people say that what these other people are doing is not good.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't have to be, you know, criminal behavior. It could be belching in church.
Yeah.
That gets to be characterized as rude.
So
and then the next thing is we have rude people. And then you say, do we want those rude people in our church? And maybe we make a rule that anybody belches in church, out.
I think in some ways, I think your point gets to another point here in terms of your work gets lumped in with labeling. And you whenever you mention this in your writing, you put labeling in quotations there because you want to distinguish your work.
Well, labeling is not the crucial thing, you know.
Right.
I mean, it's obviously something. If you give it a name, then it gets easier to say, it's one of those.
Right.
So that's not nothing.
Okay.
But it wasn't a theory of labeling. It was a theory. It wasn't really a theory in the sense that people mean that. I wasn't saying that this is what always happens. I was saying when this happens, this is how it happens.
Mm-hmm.
And if it doesn't happen, you know, congratulations. I mean, that's a finding too.
Yeah.
World doesn't have to come out the way I said it would. Because to me, the world gets priority.
Mm-hmm.
If it comes out the way it comes out, that's too bad for my idea.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not shocked and I'm not upset. I'm glad, because then I've learned something.
So there's...
But, I mean, the labeling theory, I mean, the guy who was much more responsible for it was Ed Lemert.
Mm.
You know, because Ed took that very seriously and made a much bigger deal out of it than I did.
All right.
But we were on the same track, you know, it was the same idea. And his empirical work is wonderful.
There was seemed to be a gap there between the initial steps in that direction with some of your early work that built on your thesis that was included in The Outsiders.
Well,
so during that 10 years, are you kind of developing or thinking about, is it kind of sitting in your mind?
Goffman and I both had a problem, which is Erving would write 60, 70 page papers, too long for a journal article. No journal would publish.
Mm-hmm.
They'd publish something the size of, you know, Cooling the Mark Out, but not a 70 page paper.
Mm-hmm.
And his problem, and he wrote, that was the length that he found congenial. So his solution to the problem was to put two of them in one book and find some general name for it, and that would be the book. Then he would have a book. Because a book was, you know, career currency, you could say. I had written in 1953 or so essentially the non-empirical chapters, but not about musicians, not about marijuana, of Outsiders, the first two and the last two. I'd written a 60 or 70 page paper, a la Goffman, with that material. And I didn't know what to do with it, so I put it, you know, in a drawer and forgot about it. And then around 1960 or so, I sent it to Erwin Deutscher, who was, you know that name?
No.
He was the head of a delinquency research center at Syracuse. He was a student of Robert Havenstein, who was a member of this glorious generation at Chicago, and was a professor at Missouri, the University of Missouri. And Erwin Deutscher studied with him. And he had this outfit, and I trusted Erwin's judgment. So I said, I'm going to send you this, and tell me what you think. Is it worth doing something with? So he wrote back and said, yeah, I think this is great. He said, why don't you put what you wrote about, published about musicians, and what you published about marijuana in between the first part and the last part, and that'll be a book. Okay. Well, of course, the musician thing is only shoehorned into the idea of labeling. Marijuana has some relation to it, although I didn't make it very explicit. So then there's a book, and now it's a book length. Now what? Well, I mean, you have to, you know, this is the way the world works. It's not about big theoretical ideas. Ned Polsky, who had been a student at Chicago, never graduated. He wrote a book called Hustlers, Pool Hustlers, about pool hustlers.
Oh.
I forget the
A friend of mine references it on occasion.
Yeah. You should read it. It's, it's a very interesting book. So Ned had become an editor at the Free Press. Free Press was originally a Chicago outfit, and then it moved to New York. So I put it together, and I sent it to Ned, and I said, what do you think? So he liked it. But Jeremiah Kaplan was the head of Free Press. He didn't think anybody would buy it. And there was a big argument, and finally Jerry said, all right, you know, you can publish it. And so it got published. And it hit a nerve somewhere, you know. Well, I think it's not a... It shouldn't have been a surprise.
In
the sense that there's a new generation of teachers now, 1963, who who don't want to use Ogburn and Nemcoff and, you know, all these canned textbooks, and especially social disorganization, which was how all that material was taught, as social disorganization. And those were the books, and there would be, you know, mental illness and suicide and crime and chapters for each one. Do you ever look at an old...
I've seen a handful of the old, Sutherland's, of course, is kind of within the criminological canon is kind of the one.
Well, Sutherland is a special case.
Yeah. I mean, it's,
but social disorganization or social problems, you know, were bread and butter courses along with the family.
Mm-hmm.
The family was for girls. And you better believe it, it was. And there was a...
So then this, the labeling perspective displaced this. I'm kind of wondering what happened to labeling at a certain point. Do you have any idea of why it was no longer?
It got subjected to theorization.
Huh.
So people, you know, took it. It's like my colleague at Northwestern, John Kitsoussi. You know, God bless him. Was a wonderful person and a very smart sociologist. John had a problem with outsiders. And the problem was with the little fourfold table. Right? And the problem was about secret deviance. If deviance is what's labeled as deviant, how can there be something that's secret deviance because it's something that hasn't been labeled? It's a logical contradiction. Well, to me, that was easy to take care of. You say, okay, this is behavior that if somebody wanted to, they could find the evidence to convince somebody else that this had happened. Uh-huh. But John said, but no, it's you're destroying the logic. And to me, that's the sin of theorizing.
You also don't buy much into the critique that's typically offered against this about, well, how do you explain primary deviance? All the onus, all the effort seems to be in explaining the reaction to the initial act.
Well, I wasn't particularly interested. See, I didn't make a big deal out of the reaction. That was Lemmert's. Lemmert was the one who did primary and secondary deviance. And of course there's something to it.
Mm-hmm.
If you get busted and have a criminal record, you will pay for that, and you will pay for it in ways that lead you to doing other things that you could get in trouble about. I mean, that's not, nothing to argue with about that.
Huh.
but that was Ed's thing. You know, he was, because I wasn't into, what I was into was the construction of a social category as a general. See, the logical outcome of labeling theory for me, in my work, is the book on art, where art is whatever people agree to call art.
It sounds like the Andy Warhol definition.
Well, it's the realistic definition that everybody buys, except when they're busy defining art.
Well, it kind of reminds me of, you've got one of your famous favorite quotes listed on your website there, that reality is nothing but a collective hunch by Lily Tomlin. It sounds like I hear echoes of W.I. Thomas in a lot
of
that,
course.
In terms of,
I mean,
what is the definition of the situation?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I don't think Lily ever read W.I. Thomas. That's right. So that, you know, I was not interested in defending things where there was empirical evidence that it ain't like that. If it ain't like that, it ain't.
So in another one of our interviews, another criminologist, I don't know if you know Gil Geis, kind of suggested in some way, I don't know if he had a conversation with you or anything along those lines, or he'd written.
We had lots of conversations.
He suggested there that you just had said what you had to say on deviance, and you moved on to other kind of fronts, to art and back to education.
I think that's, in conventional terms, that's right.
Yeah.
Because, see, I don't think of these as different fields.
Uh-huh.
like, you know, education.
Or you
I refuse to call myself a sociologist of education.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you do that, the next thing you know is you're embroiled in a discussion that is absolute nonsense, which is, what is the subject matter of the sociology of education?
Mm-hmm.
Well, what do you think it is? I would say to people in that racket, do you think my marijuana paper is an article about education?
No.
I say no.
Yeah.
I said, well, what do you? Why not? I mean, it's about somebody learning something,
hmm.
and somebody teaching somebody something.
Huh.
Well, what it turns out is what everybody knows is that the sociology of education is the sociology of schools.
Huh.
Period. That's what it's about.
Huh.
And if you write a book like Edgar Friedenberg wrote, Coming of Age in America, in which he suggests that the typical school should be compared logically to a jail.
I think I remember seeing that, yes.
And he points out, you know, that nobody can leave.
The total, total institution.
Permission. They can't go to the toilet
no.
without permission.
No.
He said, what, you know, I don't know what that is, but it's not about teaching somebody something. Unless you want to say it's teaching people to be docile.
So for you, is it the kernel seem to be, am I reading this right? You correct me if I'm wrong here, about just social interaction just in general, how ideas are, I suppose,
well,
communicated?
Well, yeah, I mean, for me, you know, I published a book of papers called Doing Things Together. That's what it's about.
Okay.
I mean, right, and there, it, that's the whole thing.
If I recall correctly, that links back to your Chicago roots
yeah,
in some sense, too.
That's,
yeah.
That's, in a way, that's what Herb Bloomer was always talking about.
All right.
That's what George Herbert Mead is talking about.
All right.
And that's a very open thing. It says you can go any place where people are doing something together, and if you're at all observant, you'll see that there are people doing something together, even if they're not all in the same room at the same time. Like, if you're an instrument maker and you make a piano and he's a tuner and he tunes the piano and you own a bar and you buy the piano for your bar and have the tuner come and tune it, you all of us are engaged. When I come to play, I'm not all by myself. And it's that's what sociology is about for me.
You in a lot of your methodological work, I think you do a fantastic job of addressing a question that seems to be kind of vexing the criminological community here in terms of this level of a measurement divide. So you have the macro camp, and even below that you have, down below that, you have the micro camp. You've always made the pitch that the micro informs the macro. Could you maybe give us a little bit of a spiel here in terms of the value of reasoning from
where
cases?
Where else would the macro come from?
How do you build to the macro from the micro in a?
Well, I mean, I hate to be obvious, but by going and looking,
mm-hmm.
seeing what the links are.
Okay.
I mean, how does for instance, if a macro measurement is a crime rate,
mm-hmm.
okay, fair enough. What is the step that produces the crime rate? Well, we take population figures, and we take an accepted measure of criminal activity, which is usually arrests or convictions.
We'll cut that short, and then I don't know how we want to wind this down.
So do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
It's because each one of those steps is, that's the answer to the link between. There's a wonderful paper by Bruno Latour. Which is called, it's a very bizarre title. It's called The Pedophile of Boa Vista. Boa Vista was a place in Brazil, and a a pedophile is not a not
pedophilic. Pedophile.
It's not a pedophile. It's an instrument for measuring distances. It has a wheel and you push it along. And measures out meters. And what he did was to go with a group of earth scientists who were studying the relation between the jungle and the savanna in tropical Brazil. Mm-hmm. And the question for them was, is the savanna encroaching on the jungle, or is the jungle encroaching on the savanna? Well, how do they find out? And then what he did was he documents every single step, everything. And there's one, there's a wonderful photograph that they lay the place out in square meters, 10 by 10 square meters, because they want to count things there. And then they take samples of earth from each of the 100 meter squares. They have little cardboard, white cardboard boxes, and they take a clod of earth, and he says, now, look at this photograph. This clod of earth in Brené's hand, it's just a clod of earth. Mm-hmm. When it is put in the box, it becomes evidence.
All right. And then when it's put in the test tube
the box is put in a big box with the 99 others, mm-hmm. then you have a kind of overall picture, and then blah, blah, you know, there's, mm-hmm. there's dozens of steps, and that's what that's how you get from micro to macro. I mean, I don't know why that seems mysterious to anybody. Well, I know why, because they're lazy.
Well, I think that there's been...
They don't want to do that.
There's been a very much a concerted effort to make it science by quantifying. And I think that...
Indeed, but that's...
Yeah.
How you quantify is what those guys are doing.
Yeah, all right.
And if you don't do that... It's bullshit quantification.
All right.
It's not happening.
Yeah. I want to get into some of the matters that surround this issue of how does maybe ideology, if we could use such a term, inform what's happening within the field. So maybe the first place that we might want to begin with something like that is looking at some of the conflict or some of the debate that some of your emphasis on the symbolic or the interactionist perspective within deviance, the interactionist perspective within deviance, struck some on the right as being problematic and some on the left being problematic. The right was saying that you're excusing deviance.
I was so proud of that.
Right. And the left was saying to you that you're not paying attention to the structure of things.
No, what they were saying is
power.
You're not calling things deviant, which are deviant. Why? And in fact, that's what the right was saying. I mean, mm-hmm. what Phil Selznick said to me, have you read the new book?
Right. He had that, I think you called it a killer question. What about murder is where the title comes from, right?
Why won't you call that deviant?
Right.
I said, well, if somebody calls it deviant, I'm willing to recognize that they did that. You know, because what it is an appeal to something that's beyond science.
All right.
Because what Phil meant, I mean, it's very obvious, mm-hmm. what people who attacked that from the left and the right meant is, look, some things are really bad.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you say so? We know that you think race prejudice is bad. Why won't you call that deviant?
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, because it's not.
Okay.
Or it wasn't in this time and place. These people, nobody thought they were doing anything wrong by calling somebody a pejorative name.
Mm-hmm.
They thought that was reality. So, the real argument is, what's added? What's added if I say, yes, I agree, it's really terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Now what? What do you know that you didn't know before? You know, what you know is my opinion.
In some ways, that kind of links up to this issue, and I think criminology has been very much focused on this question, and there are clear divisions here in terms of this issue of relevance. And I found a paper that you had delivered in 2003 at the European Sociological Association. I want to read a quote, an extract from this. Apparently it was in response to a couple of other papers, from what I'm inferring on the reading. And you very much raised some points there in objection to this idea, this rush to become quote-unquote relevant. Quoting you here, your paper: "My basic fear is that trying to make sociology relevant will inevitably and necessarily make it irrelevant. Why? Because we will look at, quote, problems, unquote, as they are framed by others. That will, in turn, lead us to ignore the elements of a situation that might actually be relevant to the solution of serious problems." Could you talk to us a little bit about that? Because it seems like the science, it sounds like the science in your mind is the science. Just looking at the facts as it are, getting accounts from the various parties that are party to that, and then whatever happens. At one point you were asked, you and your co-author of the Kansas study, were asked to make some policy recommendations. And you said, that's not for us.
Well, no, what I said was, I don't have a medical school. You know, I don't have any decisions to make.
Yeah.
You guys have decisions to make. Go make them.
Yeah.
Don't expect me to make them for you. I can tell you what I think would happen.
You said they wanted was a panacea.
Well, you know what they wanted? Previous consultants, because they're always having consultants in these places, you know, to help them improve their educational offerings.
Mm-hmm.
Previous consultants had suggested things like a serious change in the format of the card on which grades were recorded.
Well,
they felt that would... See, what people want is when the cause of something, the reason that the students were doing things they didn't like cramming for exams, was because...
Of the structure, the way it was
because
the semester.
Because the exam required cramming. And I said to them, well, you don't like that? I can tell you how to fix it.
Huh.
They looked at me like, really? I said, yeah.
See, with
give each student two patients, let them examine them, and then you go check out and see if they did it right. I said, well, that's not very practical. Look, you know the famous, I guess it's famous, the Ledain Commission in Canada. It was a royal commission on the non-medical use of drugs, which I thought was a wonderful title. And it was headed by Jerry Ledain, who was the dean of the McGill Law School in Montreal. And so they had hearings all over the country and whatnot. So he had me and Ed Schur, you know.
Oh yeah, he wrote a book. He wrote a book on labeling, and one of the chapters was on the labeling of blindness, which I thought was really cool.
So me, Ed Schur, and Terry Morris, who was a British criminologist, he had the three of us there, and he said, "Well, so we went out for a lunch with a lot of wine." And then he said, look, gentlemen, he said, when we convened again, he said, we've asked you what can be done about the marijuana problem, and all three of you have suggested that Canada should legalize it. He said, I put it to you, gentlemen, that the Canadian people don't want to legalize marijuana. I said, okay, you want to get rid of it? I'm going to tell you how to do it. He said, you are? I said, absolutely. He said, how? I said, well, you stop people on the street randomly. You search them. If you find marijuana on them, you execute them on the spot. You search houses randomly chosen. If you find marijuana, you burn the house down.
Hmm.
He says, are you telling me that nothing less of that will work? I said, I don't think so, but you're welcome to prove me wrong. Well, that's the whole problem right there. The problem is it's perfectly obvious what needs to be done.
Right.
Everybody knows what needs to be done. But there's all kinds of conditions. You have to solve this problem, but we can't do this. We can't do that. We can't do that. And there's no, you know, that isn't said out loud.
I think on an intellectual level here, it gets to another point, and I'm going to embarrass you again by quoting you once more here, in that there seems to be a difference between deviance and criminology and criminal justice. And you had some remarks on that in an earlier interview that appeared in 1970 in Issues in Criminology. The quote goes as such, "But somehow when sociologists study crime, they didn't understand the problem that way." You're making a justification for, you're laying the groundwork for an argument that says labeling is very much consistent, it's so congruent with sociology, it just is a natural outgrowth of that. Quoting once again, "Instead, they accepted the common notion of the common sense notion that there must be something wrong with criminals, otherwise they wouldn't act that way. They," referring to criminology and criminal justice types, "asked, quote, why do people go into crime? Why don't they stop? How can we stop them?" Unquote. The study of crime lost its connection with the mainstream of sociological development and became a very bizarre deformation of sociology, designed to find out why people were doing bad things instead of finding out the organization of interaction that's in that sphere of life. So it sounds like the policy aspects of things, the normative aspect of things, in terms of we're upset by this and we want to do something to correct this behavior because mm-hmm. we find it problematic, seems to create problems here for
an
understanding
problems.
Of
it creates problems for the people who have that idea.
Yeah,
because look, Jerry LaDane wanted to get rid of marijuana in Canada. I told him how to do it.
Uh-huh.
Didn't I?
Right.
So?
Okay.
Where's the problem?
All right. So that's not for science to... Well, science can offer that, but the politicians and the political atmosphere...
I can't make it happen.
Right. All right.
I can't make it. I mean, if it was up to me, I would wipe out every law about marijuana tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in order to do that, I would have to somehow... Managed to have more power than the president has right now.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's ludicrous. So it's one thing to understand how something works, and another thing to say, oh, now I know how to fix it. Like, people understand where earthquakes come from.
Mm.
You know, congratulations. Now what?
Great point.
Go educate them?
Do you think criminology has lost an understanding of that understanding, that appreciation for how deviance is defined? Has that left it?
I mean, truthfully, Brendan, I mean, I don't follow what criminologists do.
Yeah.
You know, I'm.
But
I'm involved in.
My understanding of how it works in sociology from the outside looking in is that sociology says if you want to study deviance, you go to criminology because that's just where it's done these days. I've heard that from a handful of experts. So, for instance, at one point in time, you could actually go into the sociology literature and find out homosexuality was labeled as a deviant, and there were all sorts of kind of explorations of that identity issue, right? Mm-hmm. And it's no longer, it's been redefined. And so mm-hmm. what we have left, I guess, is criminal activity. And so it seems like it's been kind of ushered out. Is that a fair or not?
There are so many undefined terms in what you just said.
Sociology, so where do we begin, right?
Sociology doesn't say anything.
Okay.
Sociology is like 20,000 people who belong to the ASA.
Okay.
Who say...
Are there active sessions on...
I'm sure there are.
Yeah.
There are active sessions on everything.
Right.
Do they mirror all the disagreements in whatever?
Yeah.
Of course they do.
Okay.
I mean,
See
the whole, I mean, it's a kind of mythology.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for instance, so many people are spending so much time nailing down that if a black person and a white person with exactly the same credentials apply for the same job, mm-hmm. the white person will get more callbacks than the black person. Right?
Right.
Well, I can understand that there's a question there.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to me it's been settled long ago.
Yeah. Yet
for sure that's what happens.
Uh-huh.
What is the research going to provide that is going to help anybody do anything about discrimination in employment? Because people redo this kind of,
mm-hmm.
I mean, Skolnick and Schwartz did that kind of research, you know, 30, 40, 50 years ago. So what? I mean, political action is not the same as scientific study.
Okay.
You know, you can't get there, you can't get from one to the other.
All right.
I mean, you can look at every issue that's being debated now about the environment, about you name it.
Mm-hmm.
Very often the science couldn't be clearer.
Okay.
So what?
Yeah.
That's not the science you need. What you need is the science of how to make people who are on the take from corporations behave differently.
Mm-hmm.
That would be an interesting, that's how you would solve problems like that, not by, you know, what do I have to do to get those employers to really act in a colorblind way?
All right.
How do I do that? That would be relevant research.
Okay.
I don't see anybody doing that.
Yeah. I think it's important maybe to reference, in 1967, you wrote a piece that kind of spelled that out in some measure of detail there in terms of mm-hmm. we ought to just be honest here about people having, scientists are people as well, and so they have biases, and so just recognize those expel out the limitations.
Why would anybody have to even make a point of that?
Right.
I mean,
yeah.
Who are we kidding?
But it seems like the 60s were a time when there was very much this,
well,
from the outside.
Sociology has always been infected with that do-good
okay.
thing.
Yeah.
You know, from the 1890s on.
Right.
It was very social work in the beginning.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's like the soil scientists that Latour studied maybe were interested in preventing the savanna from invading the jungle or vice versa, I don't know. But that's secondary. What they have to find out and understand is the mechanism. How does which of those things is happening? Is the savanna invading the jungle? Because if it is, how is it doing it? And if we want to stop it, which is not a scientific question.
Hmm.
I mean, you can do science from now till doomsday and not get the answer to that question, what we want.
Mm-hmm.
That's another story.
Yeah.
And that's what's going on with all this stuff.
All right.
Do we really want to get rid of crime? Well, I don't know. I'm not sure I want to get rid of crime.
Yeah. Two questions to kind of round things out here, to kind of put a capstone on things in a bit of a way. Looking back at the career that you have, and you're still actually actively engaged in some measure of research here, are there any, you have any second thoughts on sort of maybe if I would have done this or?
Every day.
Yeah. Are there any major ones that kind of stand out?
No.
Yeah.
I mean, when I've thought of things to do differently, I've done them differently.
Yeah.
I like the book I'm writing now, it has a title that I'm very fond of, so I have to finish it so I can use the title. The title is, Shall We Believe What People Tell Us, or Shall We Go Look For Ourselves?
Yeah.
And then subtitle, Data, Evidence, and Ideas. And what it's about is how we use the observations we make, the data, as evidence in support of an idea.
Hmm.
And that's, you know, in a way, that's my latest version of what I'm trying to say.
I know you're a big fan of this this piece of work called Going Out. the kind of...
Oh, the Harvey Mollett.
Yeah. To tell, it seems like it, this leads us into the sort of the last theme here to discuss, in that some advice to young graduate students seem to be, get off your duff and go out and just sort of explore.
Yeah, Robert Park said it, you know.
Yeah.
Doesn't get any better than that.
I'm wondering if that ties in any way, because I could see some people having a complaint there that the way the profession is kind of laid out these days, and the publish kind of orientation here, and you always worry about things like null findings, but it doesn't seem like you've ever encountered a null finding here.
Well, the way I work, you can never.
Yeah.
How can you have a null finding?
Huh.
I don't have hypotheses that have to be proved.
Yeah.
So that you could have, oh, I didn't prove it. What I have is an exploratory question. What are these people doing?
All right.
How are they getting it done? What understandings do they invoke as a way of getting cooperation about this and that? Well, you can't get a null finding about that. I mean, the most null finding you get is they aren't doing it. Okay, well then there's nothing to study. Nobody's doing anything. But usually you know that they are doing something.
But
may not know what.
It sounds like the proper way to go about things is building the effort in defining or creating, drafting the right research question. Having an interesting question might be.
Well,
is that where the emphasis is put in terms
of?
In a way,
it wouldn't be wrong to say that you start by finding an answer.
Huh.
Then you figure out what question that's an answer to.
Huh. That's an interesting way to think about things.
Well, I mean, I knew when I started the marijuana thing, I knew that people learned how to be high. I mean, I knew that because I'd seen it. I'd had people describe that to me. So the question was, is that really how it happens, you know, in general? So I asked a lot of people, what was your experience when you first smoked dope? And then they told me, and it was either congruent with that or it wasn't.
Maybe a fitting way to end would be on.
I mean, look, that's no different from somebody who starts a project with the idea, with a hypothesis.
Huh.
I mean, Lindy had a hypothesis. This is how addiction comes about. He got to that hypothesis because he had talked to a bunch of junkies and they told him things that made it sound like that was it. Then he went and kind of systematically tried to check that out.
All right. So he has to validate that in some
way. He doesn't have
or
to validate.
Check. Or...
What he has to do is, in case somebody says to him, you know, Lindy, that's bullshit.
I'm thinking of Margaret Mead's efforts, right? That became came under scrutiny at some point there in terms of.
Yeah, that's quite a different kind of question.
Yes.
It's like halfway around the world.
Right, and so it's anthropological in nature.
Not only that, those people aren't there anymore.
All right.
By the time Margaret wrote her book, you know, those people were grown up and had their own kids, and the world was a different place.
Yeah.
So that's a kind of a specious argument.
Understood.
You know? It's not real.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not to say that Margaret Mead may not have had some illusions.
Yeah.
That's a separate question.
I think the worry or the concern, I think, within criminology about the vanishing space that's allocated to qualitative research is that there's an enormous amount of effort that's put into producing a handful, maybe, as opposed to dozens of articles that you can splice off of.
Well, all right, but that's a question about career management.
So, yeah, and you have
about science.
So you have some thoughts there in terms of how the profession is actually structured. I suppose in terms of how could we maybe
the profession is structured. It's not its own doing.
Yeah.
Right. It's
yeah.
The profession is structured by educational institutions.
Yeah.
And funding mm-hmm. institutions, they're the ones who set the terms. And if you say, well, I have to do it because I can't get promoted if I don't turn out lots of articles. That's not about science. That's about where you work. And if it was me, I mean, if I found, I'm not always sure that that's true, because I know a lot of people who don't work that way, and they seem to get promoted too. If I really thought that was true and I had to work that way, I'd go find another job. I mean, that's not what I signed up for. I mean, it's like with the IRBs. I mean, that's a very down-home example of it. Remember I told you that I didn't want to be an emeritus professor because I was afraid that they would tell me I would have to submit to that procedure. And I think it's a terrible procedure. I'm not the only one. I mean, there's some very serious people who think it's terrible. And if that's what I had to do, you know, I wouldn't be able to do research. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's quite clear to me that I could never have done hardly any of the research I did if I had to get it approved by an IRB.
Because is the gripe that it's too much emphasis on the process as being sort of the end, as opposed to?
No, it's just there's a bunch of clowns who are the only people they could get to be on that committee, sitting there enforcing a set of standards that are totally unrealistic. I mean, supposing I'm doing what Goffman did.
Oh, right? The asylums.
Never mind asylums. He's walking down the street observing people.
Oh.
Right? What do you think would happen if he went to an IRB and said, I'm going to walk down the street and I'm going to watch people and I'm going to write down everything they do? So, no, you have to go get a form signed. I mean, that's not a joke.
Yeah.
Of course, but they're not all that stupid, but some of them are.
All right. Yeah.
And if that's what when I did the medical school study, now imagine this. I'm walking around with a bunch of medical students. We go into a patient's room with the doctor.
Oh, HIPAA requirements and all that.
I go into the patient's room with the medical students. Mm-hmm. Well, of course, I don't know what they do anymore, because I think they don't even allow them to examine real patients. They have surrogates, actors
who play out a script.
Who get examined.
All right.
So, but let's suppose that it was just like what I, so there I am. I walk into the room, and the woman is complaining she has a lump in her breast. And the doctor said, okay, pull your nightgown down so the students can see your breast. And here, am I supposed to stop and say, here, would you sign this release?
Yeah.
I mean, it's completely ludicrous.
Yeah.
I'm not doing anything wrong, but and the idea that a patient in a medical school hospital has any privacy is a bad joke.
Huh.
I mean, they don't have any privacy.
I'm wondering if you have any advice to young scholars outside of maybe the last and concluding quote here. This is at the tail end of the aforementioned article, making sociology relevant to society. Once again, quote, I have a solution to this dilemma here, about this relevancy here. That's sort of immaterial to the point I want to make. But I hesitate to recommend to anyone else, and so I simply offer it as the way I have found to keep doing sociological work and stay reasonably happy. It is simple. Do the best research you can, look at everything that might be worth looking at, even when others think you're wrong, and don't worry about whether anyone finds your results useful. It's the best way to produce knowledge that will really work if anyone is willing to try it. So it sounds like there's an awful lot of risk and there's gamble involved, but just have the fortitude to go out and...
Well, there's gamble in doing it the conventional way.
That's true too, yeah.
What if your hypothesis is wrong?
Right, yeah.
Then you've wasted 2 years.
Well, agendas come and agendas go, and we see that with traditions.
No, the advice I give people now is Satchel Paige's advice. And keep moving and don't look back. Something might be gaining on you.
Is there anything that I should have asked or that you'd like to have on the record that you think bears underlining?
No, you've done a kind of remarkable.
I appreciate it. It's been phenomenal learning from you, and I'm pleased to be able to share this with generations to come. Howie, well, we appreciate your time here.
Well, you know, I wonder if generations to come will pay any attention because...